Okay, I think it's 8 o'clock. Let's get rolling. Welcome to the debate of the century. What happens in the free world will be decided here in the basement of the Golden Gate Pub tonight. Actually, we were just looking for a little excitement to the big event that's going to be happening at 4 a.m. Kyiv time, the first debate between Hillary Rodham Clinton and Donald Trump tonight. So if you have insomnia, you can watch that. But tonight we're going to do a what we did 4 years ago. It was a lot of fun. But we will start by, let's see, a little audience participation. How many Americans are here tonight? Raise your hand. Ooh, this is good. This is good. How many Ukrainian citizens here tonight? Not here. Oh, wow, it's a good mix. And how many from other countries tonight? Great. And how many have not yet decided who they want to vote for out of the Americans? Raise your hands. Undecided vote. So we're debating for nothing. Everybody's made up their mind. Okay. Well, let's get started. First, as an American, I want to introduce myself. I'm Brian Bonner, the chief editor of the Kyiv Post. I am from the state of Minnesota. And full disclosure here, I am a very biased moderator. The Kyiv Post has endorsed Hillary Clinton. I am a liberal Democrat. So I will be voting for Hillary Clinton. And partly because I believe Donald Trump represents the greatest threat to our democracy in my life. But I don't believe Hillary... I don't believe Hillary Clinton deserves a free pass, and so she should get the tough questions. And I would ask you guys to be nice to Jonathan Roiland. He's the only American in Kyiv we could find who would stand up for Donald Trump. So be kind.
Thank you.
He's a businessman here from Colorado, and he can tell more about himself during the program. This guy is a veteran, Reno Domenico, president of Sterling Business School, chairman of Democrats Abroad Ukraine. He was a delegate at the Democratic National Convention in Philadelphia this summer. And he will be representing Hillary Clinton tonight. But first, we didn't find a singer to do the national anthem.
But I can do it.
You can?
Yes.
Give the lady a microphone. Really? We will have it. What's your name?
My name is Nini Yankovic. I'm a Fulbrighter.
All right.
I love Fulbright.
Let's stand for our national anthem, folks.
Hats off.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so bright broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets
the end. First, that was fantastic. Let's go. I want to thank, first of all, Hromadske International, which is live streaming this event to millions and millions of people worldwide. And Natalia Guminyuk, the head there, who has gently or kindly given us the cutouts of our two candidates here tonight. And she asked me to talk about Hromadske's special weekly program on the U.S. presidential race named hashtag Hillary Trump, right? And so please follow hashtag Hillary Trump throughout the presidential campaign. Now we're going to start. Opening remarks, Jonathan.
Reno.
Oh, no, Reno. Reno starts. Keep it brief, Reno. 3 minutes. I'll be the timer.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for attending. I appreciate it very much. I want to thank the Golden Gate Pub for allowing us to use this venue again. It really is difficult to believe that it was 4 years ago we were having a debate between Barack Obama, who I think has been a great president, and is going to be a tough act to follow. It's going to be a tough act to follow, but we're going to have to do our best, and we're going to make it happen. I also would like to thank the Kyiv Post. The Kyiv Post does immeasurable community service work. I know sometimes it probably wears on Brian a little bit, but without the Kyiv Post, for the English-speaking community in town, it would be very, very difficult. And I also would like to thank Natalia and Hromadske TV for live streaming this, not only for the audience that's in the room, but for everybody that's able to watch at home. And last, I would like to thank my opponent, Jonathan Roseland. Jonathan is the only person who was willing to come this evening and stand up for Donald Trump publicly. I respect that. I think it's in the American tradition. Since we started having political debates, Lincoln, Douglas, and even before that, it's an important part of being an American that we have this right to exercise our opinion and understand what this election means for all of us. This debate this evening, I hope it does set the tone for the kind of debate we'll see later on this morning, Kyiv time. But I think that I'm not going to take the direction of trying to point out the flaws that Donald Trump clearly exhibits as a candidate. Instead, I would like to tell you a little bit about what happened when I was in Philadelphia this summer. I was very fortunate coming from what is a small Democrats Abroad chapter here in Ukraine to be elected as a delegate to the Democratic National Convention. It was one of the greatest experiences of my life, and I was able to see firsthand the kind of leadership that Hillary Clinton can provide the United States of America. Hillary Clinton is, as President Obama said, the most qualified person ever to run for President of the United States, the most prepared person ever to run for President of the United States. And Hillary has gotten a bad rap in many regards because she has a wonderful record when you really look at it, going back to her work with the Children's Defense Fund when she was a young lawyer, to her days in the White House with Bill Clinton. And by the way, when Bill was president, we all had money in our pocket. When she was in the White House, she fought for health care. Everybody knows that didn't go well, but her commitment to health care for all Americans goes back a long, long time. And out of that experience, she helped develop the Children's Insurance Fund, which funds over 8 million children's health insurance in the United States this very day. That's a tremendous accomplishment. As Secretary of State, Barack Obama selected her to be his secretary. She was instrumental in the Iran sanctions regime. She was one of the most traveled Secretary of States in the history of the United States, organized the Hamas ceasefire, and I think she will bring a wealth of experience and knowledge to the presidency of the United States.
Thanks, Reno. Jonathan.
Hey, I'm Jonathan from Colorado. I also want to express my thanks to the various parties that came together to make this happen, and to my opponent, Reno. So I'm here for one issue that is most important to me, and I'll make the case why it should be most important to you guys. And that issue is war. I hate war. And if there's one thing that I'm actually really ashamed of my country for, it's that my country has been at war with the rest of the world for so long. the bodies, the smoldering bodies that have resulted from the foreign policy of the United States for the last 20 years would form a mountain that would reach to the sky. And it has accomplished nothing. Trillions of dollars and millions of bodies later, we have nothing to show for our wars of aggression that have been waged by the Republicans and the Democrats. Now, there are three criteria that we have to use to make fairly accurate predictions about what our politicians are going to do in the future. The first of those is what their financial incentives are. This is probably the best indicator. Secondly, what their past behavior is. And thirdly, what they say they are going to do. Hillary Clinton certainly means more war for the world. And that's something that I have a visceral level of disgust about. And that's really probably my primary reason for supporting Trump.
Okay, Jonathan, thanks. As the moderator, I get the first question. Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
We will be civil tonight. This is not a Donald Trump rally, so everybody should be safe from violence. Okay. Hey, you laugh now, but you might not laugh later. The first question to Jonathan, it's about character. Trump has called, demeaned women as fat pigs, has zero support in the African-American community, has insulted Hispanics, saying that they're sending rapists and other criminals to America. He is the first candidate who doesn't release his taxes. What is he hiding in those? And how can a man who talks in such a demeaning and insulting way about people, all kinds of people, be president? Isn't that disqualifying his character alone?
Almost all of the statements that there is outrage around him are statements that are taken very far out of context. That if we look at the individual statements, we'll find that they are either a banter type statement or that they are something that's fairly reasonable. But to the point of political correctness, I think what we're seeing is that we're seeing that a large part of the country is not concerned about political correctness, they're concerned about correctness. And if a statement is reflective of reality, people are not caring as much about if it's not as nice as politicians have spoken for a long time. To another point, there are you can look up Latinos, you can look up leaders in the Black community, you can look up Sikhs, you can even look up a number of Muslims that are supporting Donald Trump because his policies are pro-American. They may not be pro other countries in the world, but they are pro for Americans.
Okay, thanks, Jonathan. I have the same character question for you, Reno, about Hillary. Hillary has been in the establishment, crooked Hillary, has been in the establishment for so long. She seems to change her positions, has no courage of her character. She changes her positions on Iraq and other important issues for America. The Clintons devised the pay for play. And when Bill was philandering with other women, she led the attack against these women to intimidate them, not to come forward with the abuse that Bill was accused of. Moreover, she destroys her emails, classified emails. And isn't this disqualifying? Can we trust her?
Well, that's you covered a lot of territory there, Brian. And I think, first of all, there are no perfect human beings in this world. And there certainly are no perfect human beings in politics. And to suggest that Hillary Clinton has never made a mistake would be foolish on my part or on anybody's part, and I don't think that she said that. But let's start with your last part of the question, which is the emails. If that's all you've got in this election, that we're going to list all the important things that are really critical to the United States of America. Jonathan talked about endless war, health insurance for all Americans, educational policy, a real immigration reform, and then you stacked up that against 33,000 missing emails. I think we're really missing the point. We're going to be really in deep water. However, think that anybody running for president of the United States is going to have a track record. You just don't get there very easily, and you're always going to be able to find something you don't like that somebody did. I think on the balance, Hillary Clinton not only is trustworthy, but she has a track record of experience and success in actually accomplishing things.
Okay. Jonathan, do you have any rebuttal or question for Reno?
Yes, I do. Okay, so those 33,000 emails, those represent many, many operations that the United States is doing around the world. That is in a very serious compromise of our security, and that's actually a compromise of a lot of lives of Americans that are around the world. And this issue of the email servers, after the FBI devoted a ton of time to studying this, devoted many, many resources, what did James Comey come out and say? He said it was extremely careless. And that's very, very strong wording from someone that spent so much time examining this issue. And this issue, what it does is it either shows her as having a ethical standard that is below what I think is acceptable in a president, or showing that she is extremely careless. And either way, that disqualifies her.
Reno, your brief rebuttal, please.
Again, we're talking about emails here. That's what we're talking about. There's no evidence that any of these emails compromise national security. I believe that the director of the FBI, who was a Republican appointee, by the way, has made it very clear that there was no criminal wrongdoing. Hillary has said having a private server was a mistake. Personally, I wish she had been more forthcoming about that and had been more clear about it, but she said it was a mistake. She wouldn't do it again. She made a mistake. That's what happened.
Okay, now we get to the more interesting part, to the audience. Now, raise your hand, identify yourself if you have a question. I'll give the first right to Natalia from Hermansky if you have one. Not now? All right. Anybody? Come on. You, sir, identify yourself. And Artem, get the microphone,
please.
Hey,
I'm Hans Ellis from Florida. I have an orphan charity.
Hold on. Wait a minute.
I'm Hans Ellis from Florida, and I have a little orphan charity that comes here a couple of times and does work, and so I'm happy to be back in Ukraine. But Hillary says, and all her fans say, that she's the smartest woman in America. We hear that a lot from her friends in the media. But if she's so smart, why didn't things turn out better in Libya, and in Syria, and in Egypt, and in Iraq, where ISIS is kind of running the show to some degree? And finally, why aren't they turning out better in East Ukraine?
Okay, Reno, you start.
Where in Florida are you from?
Destin.
Where?
Destin.
Northwest Florida. Glad to have you here. First of all, I don't think anybody said she was the smartest woman in the United States. I think that's a huge, assumption on anybody's part. And world events do have a pace of their own. I do believe that when Hillary Clinton is president of the United States, you're going to see a more robust foreign policy than possibly we've seen under Barack Obama. I think the reality of what happened when Mr. Obama became president is that he probably got a little bit gun-shy from the fact that we got mired in Afghanistan, mired in Iraq, and the Iraq war was clearly a war that was fought without purpose. We took our eye off the ball. We've lost 4,500 men. And Jonathan, if you want to have an investigation about something, when are we going to have an investigation about how we got into the Iraqi war? Because we've lost 4,500 men, and we've never had an investigation about that, but we've investigated Benghazi 7 times.
Okay, Jonathan, do you want to talk?
Yeah, I'll say that if Hillary Clinton is elected to be president on November 9th, the CEOs in the corner offices of the defense contractors around the United States will be popping champagne because of the payday that is coming. She has taken, on paper, this is just the tip of the iceberg, over $450,000 in campaign contributions from the defense contractors, and Trump has taken just $10,000, barely enough money to have a fun night in one of his hotels.
Okay, let's... Okay. I'll take a question from Lada, the Canadian in the room. Go ahead.
Canadian American.
I'm American Canadian. Jonathan, I have a question for you. In your quick 3 minutes that you stuck to and is appreciated, you mentioned that both the Republican Party and the Democratic Party were warmongering across the planet. Considering the fact that Trump is from the Republican Party, you're saying that he has something else to offer, what exactly does Trump have to offer that differentiates itself from the Republican Party and the Democratic Party?
Well, his foreign policy speech, which is probably my favorite speech of his, he said that his credo is going to be Americanism, not globalism. And his emphasis has been on building the American economy. That's the main thing that he talks about. That's probably the thing that has garnered him the most attention. And he has the most vested interest in building the American economy, because that's what his empire has as a foundation. So again, look at the carrots and sticks that are being offered to the candidates, and this is a candidate that has very different financial incentives than any other candidate that I can remember in my lifetime having.
There's so much here, I really don't know where to go. I will tell you this. I made a concerted effort to try to understand what is the real Donald Trump position on practically anything. And it was a huge struggle. What I did was I went to Donald Trump's website, Make America Great Again, and I looked for the positions papers there that would explain what he wanted to do. There is nothing on his website about defense spending. Zero. I do hear when he gives a speech that he's going to make America's military the greatest in the world, which it already is. He doesn't explain how he's going to pay for whatever expansion he was talking about. He never made that clear. And I want to go back to the question that the young lady from Canada asked, and that is, she mentioned East Ukraine, or maybe with the gentleman from Florida. Well, the fact of the matter is that Donald Trump and his campaign, I believe, are completely embedded in this Russian project. And it's entirely possible, I'm not a CIA person, but it's entirely possible that the Trump campaign is a Russian project.
Let's continue with that theme, Jonathan. Donald Trump has angered many Ukrainians and many supporters of Ukraine by saying he would consider recognizing Russia's illegal annexation of Crimea. He's called Vladimir Putin a person who is one of the biggest tyrants in the world. He's called him a great leader. He refuses to release his tax returns, which suggests to many people that he's on the payroll of the Kremlin. How do you respond?
That's a juicy conspiracy theory. I would just look at Trump's statements, which his statement was that Putin is not going to come into Ukraine underneath his presidency. A couple of interviewers have pushed Donald Trump on this point because the world wants to know. And what he said was he made a very adamant statement where he was like, under me, he's not going in. He's not going in. And okay, so Trump's not the president, obviously. What was called the Budapest Memorandum. There was this deal that Ukraine made where Ukraine was like, we're going to give up our nukes in exchange for we expect that NATO is going to come to our rescue if Russia. So the Obama administration, the Democrats, have betrayed that deal that Ukraine had made in Budapest.
Okay, let's go to a couple things. First, I want an answer to what do you think Donald Trump is hiding in his taxes? The fact that he's getting money from Russians, like a lot of his aides, a lot of his assistants, the fact that he's a poor businessman, the fact that he doesn't pay any taxes. What do you think is hiding there?
Well, no business person worth their gravy would put out their tax returns if they're being audited by the IRS. That's the official answer. There's also Donald Trump is, I don't believe that he's a perfect candidate. I believe that there's probably some stuff in his tax returns that, yeah, he doesn't want people to know about, but I don't know of any evidence that would suggest that he's on the payroll of the Russians. That's actually the first time I've heard that.
Paul Manafort, Carter Page, the General Kelly, Michael Kelly. All right, let's go to Reno. We'll play the tape back 4 years. We had this debate, and I did watch it. You were very passive about the threat that Russia posed. Mitt Romney correctly called Russia the number one geopolitical threat, and you dismissed that. And Barack Obama has not, he's the first president since Ronald Reagan not to come to Ukraine as president. He also refused defensive weapons. Hillary had this disastrous reset as Secretary of State. What makes you think that she'll be any better as president?
Well, I think, first of all, there's so many things to respond to here at one time. But let me try to answer your question for you, Brian. There is no doubt that circumstances have certainly changed since the last 4 years. No one, I think, could have anticipated what has happened either in Ukraine or what has happened with Crimea and what has happened in eastern Ukraine.
Not true.
Well, but nevertheless, I may have been able to anticipate it, but I don't think it was anticipated by people in government. That being said, here we are today. We know that Paul Manafort was organizing Donald Trump's campaign. Paul Manafort was deeply involved with the previous government here in Ukraine. I believe Paul Manafort's money is still here in Ukraine somewhere, in some apartment, and just can't get it out, because $12 million is a lot of money to move. But let's try to put this in some context. I think Hillary Clinton understands the world that we live in, and she hasn't gone around saying that that Vladimir Putin is a great leader, that she admires him. She hasn't complimented Kim Jong-un as being a role model. She doesn't have David Duke as one of her main supporters. And there is a vast difference between the two people. Again, I think people learn a lesson. I think people make mistakes. Probably we would have really appreciated a much more robust America here in Ukraine. But I will say this, if America is not involved in Ukraine and Great Britain is not involved in Ukraine, this entire sanctions regime against Russia is going to collapse.
Okay, thanks, Reno. I have 1994 Budapest Memorandum signed by the United States, Great Britain, Ukraine, and Russia. It turned out, Ukraine was convinced to surrender its nuclear weapons in exchange for security guarantees that have turned out to be worthless so far, or not worth much. And the credibility of the United States and Great Britain, I think, is still an issue, because unless the war ends and unless Ukraine gets Crimea back. And moreover, if you're talking about reducing nuclear weapons, it would be hard-pressed to look at any other country that would willingly surrender its nuclear weapons in exchange for paper guarantees from any foreign power. So that's my comments on
the Budapest Memorandum. Let's go to the audience. I feel Teres Kuzio has a question.
No, it's a point. You keep using the word guarantees.
Wait.
The word guarantees does not exist in the Budapest Memorandum. You're actually spreading the falsehood. It's security assurances, not security guarantees. It's a big difference. The West did not guarantee anything. You're right, there's a moral aspect to this, where Britain and the US should be part of the Normandy or Minsk process. But there's no guarantee.
Okay, point taken. Do you have any questions? Or are you just correcting my history? All right, questions. Natalia.
But before that, I kindly ask the participants to speak on the mics if you want. It is preserved for history, anything you told or all the debate. So thanks. And Jonathan as well, so please speak on the mic. So the question is, Reno, to you. You know, we understand that a lot depends on the fact that the American public really doesn't support the current establishment and is very, very tired of that. That's something where a lot of people would vote against the second Clinton in the White House. So how she's gonna, and what is your opinion? How you can answer that, that it's really the second generation of Clinton, somebody who is very far away from a lot of people. So how you would answer that? And the question to Jonathan, you said that what Trump says is good for the Americans, but then what the world should do? Should the allies just forget that the U.S. is there and the U.S. would follow just their own foreign policy? Thank you. And please talk to the mics.
Yes.
Shall I go first, Jonathan, or you?
You can go first on that.
I think this is a political question, correct, Natalia? You're talking about the American political condition. There is no doubt that there is dissatisfaction inside the American electorate, right or wrong. And there is no doubt that there is dissatisfaction, particularly in the white working class, and particularly males in the white working class. And I really, personally, I think both parties are responsible for that. However, reality is a strange thing. It really captures things and forces action. The 2008 relocation of the economy, of the world economy, was massive. And that change is permanent. And what you cannot do is you can't suggest that the solution lies in the past. We are not going back to some economy that existed in 1960, when the US was 60% of world GDP. Those days are gone. China is not a poor country anymore. India is developing. Globalized world is here forever. I'll tell you, you want to talk about lies, Jonathan. One of the greatest lies being perpetrated in this election is for somebody to go into Appalachia, into coal country, and tell those people that we're going to bring coal back. You're a smart guy. You're pretty much a modern web developer. You know what's happening. You know coal is not coming back. Those days are gone. Coal is $40 a ton cheaper than natural gas. Natural gas supplies are growing exponentially. We are not going to rebuild Appalachia with coal. We're going to have to do it with a new economy. It's going to have to be a clean economy. And that's what Hillary Clinton is talking about doing.
Okay.
So don't lie to people and tell them that there's some future in the past.
Jonathan.
Okay, so to address using my microphone now, Natalia. To address your question, so Trump has been pretty adamant that he's going to try to focus on what is good for the American people, as opposed to trying to be a savior to the rest of the world, which is what everyone feels like the Barack Obama has tried to be. And I think the result, what we're seeing here in Ukraine, what we see in Syria, Libya, is we see instability as a result of trying to do all that. So to address your point, yeah, there is the economy is changing on a fundamental level in the United States. And what we badly need is we need for the government to get out of the way of job creators and for the government to get out of the way of industry in the United States. And a lot of those people that are in Appalachia, what they're seeing is they're seeing a sliding down into into becoming a place like Venezuela, into becoming a place like Greece. We have this obscene amount of debt, and we see our economy and our future and our industry constricting, and Trump is offering some solutions that make sense to a lot of people.
Okay, let's go to the audience. Sir, back there. Or don't, yeah. Stay, you should stay in the audience, because we're going to keep going.
No, go ahead.
Identify yourself, ask the question.
Yes, my name is Jeff, just Jeff. I've been listening to both of you, and thank you both for presenting yourselves as surrogates for both candidates. And I've noticed a little bit that the debate, such as it is, has become a little bit policy free.
Like the campaign.
I just have one question for both of you, actually. If you could name one thing, one domestic policy proposal, concrete domestic policy proposal, of your favorite candidate, could you explain why it's good and why you like it? What's your favorite thing, domestic policy?
Who wants that? Jonathan, go ahead. Or Reno, whoever is ready, jump in.
I'll give you three. First one is the $225 billion infrastructure rebuild project. I think that is crucial. Most of the people in this room, the Americans here, travel widely. You've been around the world. Our airports are in bad shape. Our train service is terrible compared to what you can get in Europe or even Ukraine. We have faster train service in Ukraine than we do in most parts.
So Hillary will make America great again.
I think Hillary will start the rebuild. America already is great. And again, let's not kid ourselves. Frequently I discuss this with people, and you can measure success of a country by the direction in which people move. And what is Donald Trump's big campaign theme? He wants to build a wall to keep people from coming to the United States. Nobody running to get out of the United States. People are rushing to get in. Second big project is making college affordable for most Americans by having public colleges free for American students up to $125,000. And the third proposal, which is to expand Medicare so that anybody who's 55 years and older can buy into the Medicare program, because the Affordable Health Care Act has been a great step forward, but in no doubt it needs to be fixed. And in a normal political environment where Congress would actually work on some of these things, refused, so you have not been able to amend it and fix it, but I think one of her proposals is to get the Affordable Health Care Act expanded to include more Americans. So those are the three principal proposals.
Okay, Jonathan.
Thanks for going first. You gave me the opportunity to think up a really good one. So I'll just do one policy that I really like of Donald Trump's, which I think is really important, is his tax plan. His tax plan is to lower taxes on the middle class. It's also, as you're probably aware, it's to lower taxes on business. And a third-party accounting firm, a nonpartisan accounting firm, examined Trump's tax plan, and I read a lot of it, but the conclusion of it is particularly important. In the conclusion, they said that his tax plan is going to increase incentives for people to work and for people to save. And those are things that are really badly needed in the United States, and it's going to mean less of the government stealing your money, which if you're an American citizen and you pay taxes, what is really better than you having more control over your own money? And real quick point, those three foreign policies that you mentioned are all government programs. It's infamously incompetent in getting those types of things done. You were a former principal, so if you can convince some of your former coworkers to work for free, then maybe we should have free college. But if you can't, then maybe people are...
Okay. I'm sure Rena will come back to this later, but I have a question, because Trump strikes me as a little bit crazy, like you might actually use nuclear, I'm trying to be polite, might actually use.
Frightens me. He makes NATO allies nervous. He seems to be thin-skinned and in the awe of dictators. Do I have him wrong, or is that pretty much right?
So Trump is about 70 years old, and for about 40, 50 years, he's been doing deals all around the world, dealing with people in China, dealing with people in all around the world, and he's been very even-handed. He's been a business person getting deals done, and people really don't change their character that much around 70 years old. So if he's been a relatively peaceful person that's been able to get deals done, make things win-win for both parties for at least 40 years of his career, it's unlikely that he's going to turn into a complete madman at this stage.
Reno.
Again, I don't know where to start sometimes, but I'm going to try. I'm from New Jersey, Jonathan. I was born in Philadelphia, but I live near Atlantic City. Donald Trump has his fingerprints all over Atlantic City. His business acumen is well known there. There were four Trump casinos at one time in Atlantic City. What is happening as we sit here is workers are chiseling the last letters of Trump off the last casino that he owned in the city. All four went bankrupt. That's an example of his business acumen. Not only did they go bankrupt, but they left hundreds of workers without their severance pay, left contractors without their bills being paid. And you know, Jonathan, I do respect you for standing here. I give you a lot of credit. But a man who will not disclose his income taxes, who says he's going to be able to tell me how he's going to improve my tax position, but in the meantime, I have no idea if he's ever paid a dime of tax, not even a penny.
Okay. You made your point. Now I want to go to the, you've had a question. Do we have a question from the Democratic Feminist Caucus here? Martin.
As you guys might have noticed, I am not white. I am a minority. My parents had immigrated to America in the early 90s. Now, my father is from a Muslim country. He is from Bangladesh. It is a majority Muslim country. One of Trump's more famous statements is his proposal to ban all Muslim immigration into America. Now, setting aside the entire constitutional question here, my question to our dear friend Jonathan here is, do you think it is acceptable for a candidate for a major political party to tar an entire religion that is 1.6 billion adherents because he saw some of them cheer in New Jersey?
Good question.
Is that an acceptable position for a presidential candidate for the American people to take?
Jonathan.
Hey, okay, so it should be noted that his position was clarified a little bit on this. Initially, he had mentioned a Muslim ban. His clarified position is that he's going to look at countries that seem to be producing a disproportionate number of extremists, and that those are going to be much more highly scrutinized and or banned. What I'd like to ask you also though is, would you consider Barack Obama perhaps racist or against Muslims in the way you would Donald Trump, perhaps? You can respond. Shout it out.
It's a yes or no question.
No, no.
No. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Great. So Barack Obama has banned Venezuelans from entering the United States. I lived in Colombia for 2 years. I have a lot of great friends that are Venezuelans that are like really smart, productive people. They speak English really well. I don't really think that it's fair that they get not allowed to come into the United States because their country's having a little bit of trouble. However, what's important is that this is actually constitutional. The Constitution does give the executive branch the ability to say that we're gonna cut off immigration that we're gonna from specific countries or specific groups of people like Muslims. So it actually is constitutional if you look into it a little bit more closely.
Okay, John Reno, I think you have a rebuttal here.
Again, where to start? First of all, I guess when Jonathan says that Donald Trump is clarifying his positions, is what we see is his fudging of positions. Because it was very clear during the primaries that he stood there and said he wanted a 100% ban on all Muslims coming into the United States, whether it was Mayor Khan from London or somebody from Bangladesh like your dad would have been at one time. This is indicative of the kind of appeal, and this isn't the first time we've had this in America, ladies and gentlemen. It's always fear of the other. This is an appeal to the lowest level of understanding in American psyche. This is an appeal to racism. It's an appeal to bigotry. It's an appeal to hate. You can't justify this, Jonathan. You can't just wash it away and say it's something that he just made a mistake. Oh, he's clarifying his position. This is overt bigotry, overt racism. Whether it's a Mexican judge who was born in the United States with the same citizenship as I have. I was born, he was born. And to say that that man was not qualified to sit on in judgment because he was a Mexican, that is bigotry.
Okay, Reno. Ann, do you still have your question?
Yes. I was trying to fact check the Venezuela issue.
Good luck.
Didn't have a chance to type fast enough to find out what it says on the U.S. Embassy website about visas for Venezuelans. 99% sure that Venezuelans are permitted to travel to the United States with proper documentation and visas. But we'll come back to that. My question for both of you is that we have had relatively young presidents for the last 24 years. How, as people pushing 70 and people already over 70, how will your candidates relate to a young generation, to the future of the United States, to the future of the world, where in many countries around the world, the young generation is the majority of the population? And how will you balance that, or how will your candidates balance that with an aging population in the U.S. and the burden of Social Security and caring for our retired population?
And will we fall asleep at cabinet meetings like radio?
Who wants to take that first?
I'll take that first. Yeah, this actually concerns me a little bit. I see Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, and I'm like, they seem just a little bit old to be going for one of the most stressful jobs that's out there. However, Donald Trump is, for whatever reason, he is very relatable for millennials like myself. It probably has to do with him being in the public spotlight in reality TV for so long. So I think people find him very relatable. I'm sorry, I didn't hear that much of an objection in your question. Do you want to make one?
No. It's Reno, you got it.
Well, I'll probably use that Ronald Reagan line and say, listen, Jonathan, I won't use your youth against you. As someone who's getting a little close to that age, I mean, they both are up there. There's no two ways about it. They're both experienced. But if you suggest that Donald Trump is relatable to millennials, it's only probably because millennials are used to getting ripped off. And he's pretty good at doing that. So, yeah, maybe they are able to relate to him. But I think that it is a challenge. There is no doubt that this is probably the last baby boomers running for president. But they are what they are.
Okay.
I can just
go right ahead.
Fact-checked a recent statement. In 2014, the consular section of the U.S. Embassy in Venezuela processed approximately 230,000 applications for non-immigrant visas and 2,500 applications for immigrant visas, making it possible for Venezuelans from various backgrounds and walks of life to travel to the United States.
You
lied.
Yeah,
or you approved.
I may be incorrect about this one.
Okay. People make mistakes. Irina.
How can any reasonable person actually believe that Barack Obama was not born in America? Donald Trump perpetuated this ridiculous idea and finally backpedaled it. Didn't explain it. We all know what he did. So how do you justify that? I mean, that's, you know, insanity? What, you had a senior moment that lasted a couple of years, or what? What happened?
Jonathan.
Okay, this is one of these things that I just don't care about that much, and I don't think a lot of people... This, Trump's popularity would indicate a lot of people just don't care about this that much anymore. However, the one thing that seemed really suspect to me about Obama's origin was that it took him so long to produce that birth certificate. Donald Trump had to offer him $5 million before it finally worked its way out. That was a little weird. That seems suspicious to me, but it's an issue that I just don't think a lot of people care about anymore.
Let's move on. Reno, I'm going to give you a rebuttal, but I want to, Jonathan made a good point here. If Trump is so bad, why is Hillary not beating him in the polls?
Well, I can't let her question go. I got to answer that. That's
okay.
An important question. Listen, Jonathan, I'd like to think higher of you than this. Everybody knew that Barack Obama was born in the United States. There's only one reason that the issue of Barack Obama's origin was ever raised, and that was because of his ethnicity. And there's only one man who made this a personal campaign for 5 years. He perpetuated the birther movement. It is a racist movement. It was racist to the core. And you can't just wash it away. And Jonathan, you think people don't care? You think the African-American community doesn't grasp what this was all about? You think the minority community doesn't grasp what this was all about? They're not naive. They understood exactly what it's about. I'll tell you who was pleased with it was David Duke and the Ku Klux Klan and the alt-right and the American Nazi movement. They all thought it was a great idea. But I think it was cold, stone-hearted racism.
And why isn't Hillary doing better?
I can respond really quickly to that.
I'll give it.
We're still in the middle of the campaign, and there's only one poll that really counts, and that's the one that's going to happen on November 8th. But I think there are a lot of issues as to why Hillary is not further ahead. I think when a political party has been in power for 8 years, there is a natural tendency to want some change. I think that we have the first female candidate. And listen, guys, I've worked in professional life for far too long, and in that time, I can tell you, women have a harder way to go. And there's no doubt about it. I've worked with them. And when they can work, just like everybody else, I respect them and I admire them. But they get a tough, tough time. Hillary laughs, she's not serious. If she doesn't smile, look, she has no sense of humor. She can't go play golf on Sunday because that's not acceptable. People don't understand it. A lot of this is sexism. It's still in there. Let's hope tonight she puts that to rest.
Okay. What I would like to hear from is somebody who is a Ukrainian who has a question about the American election, because this year, more than other years, issues involving Ukraine and Russia are at the forefront, very close to being the top foreign policy questions that American voters will be deciding. So I would really like to hear questions from Ukrainians. I would also like to hear questions from our neighbors in Canada, because the joke is, if Trump wins, Canada's population will double, triple, quadruple. I'd like to hear from our neighbors in Mexico, but I don't think we have, I think there's only 30 Mexicans in Ukraine. Yeah, okay. You, sir, microphone, identify yourself.
Actually, from Austria, so not a
regular. Austria, okay.
But, you know, Vicente Schwarzenegger, at least we have some.
Thank you for his service.
The openness of your political system, that you accepted the immigrant to become the governor of California. And really, I love America very much. It's the most important partner of the Western countries, and we really like it very much. And we hope the best to you, but we are a bit concerned about the rise of American nationalism.
How about a question?
Concretely, a question about transatlantic trade partnership. Both candidates have said no to that, or are being critical. It's a issue here from Syria, a lot of people are coming. Can you not help us a bit? What will be your positions on that one?
The position on transatlantic trade partnerships?
Yeah.
Okay, TTIP. Who wants to take trade relations first?
Oh, you got more. I'm concerned about that one. And the thing is, you know, when we have Trump this winter, this November, then you will have in France, in Austria, in Germany, a lot of these things. Yeah? And the whole unity of the West, everything we are proud of, will break down. So please, American voters here, because I cannot vote in your election.
Okay.
Don't vote for him.
Okay, it's two questions we have on trade, and then is it really that dire? I mean, if Trump wins and then the whole Western civilization goes away. Who wants that first?
Okay, yeah, I'll take that. So the TTP, I don't think we need governments to regulate our free trade, because the buying and selling, that's something that, especially in this digital age, especially with all this stuff we have on the internet, companies can regulate their own free trade. Whenever the government tries to get in the business of free trade, it ends up adding a bunch of taxes and a bunch of tariffs, like what you see in the EU, where the EU is blocking business and entrepreneurship. And so Trump is a little bit more nationalistic. And this is for one reason. This is because you cannot have free open migration in a welfare state. If your country is in the business of giving out a lot of money and a lot of resources to those who are in need, if you make your borders wide open, you're going to attract the entire world into your country, and that's just going to be unsustainable. And that is what is at the core of the nationalism and these immigrants that are coming to your country and to my country. These people are coming because they want to live in an American society or Austrian society, and by accepting unlimited amount of people into the countries, it's going to change those countries, and it's going to cheat the people that have come out of the Western society that they want to live in.
Okay, that was a pitch for protectionism and immigration controls. What about the idea that somehow Trump endangers the unity of Western civilization? Do you agree?
No. I think that he strengthens Western civilization. His focus is on the classic Western values, which are free speech, Christianity, entrepreneurship, being able to do things on an individual level. So I think he's going to be tremendous for Western civilization.
Reno, you're too busy.
Again, I'm going to try to stick to the question the gentleman asked. First, let's talk about trade. I think that the transatlantic partnership is an important partnership and has to be pursued. As I said earlier, and I believe Hillary Clinton understands this, the globalized economy is here to stay. Yes, it does cause dislocation in the labor market. There's no two ways about that. But it is not going to go back. We're not going to roll back the clock. We're not going to build a wall between the United States and Mexico. And we're not going to get out of the World Trade Organization, which is what some of Trump's policies would actually require that we do. Now, the second part of his question is very important. And that is the rise of nationalism, not just in the United States, but across Western Europe and in the world. And I think we've seen it. We had Brexit. Brexit certainly is not helpful. It's not going to be helpful for anybody. It's not going to be helpful for Britain in the long run. Donald Trump invited Nigel Farage, who was one of the architects of Brexit, who is a nationalist, a white nationalist, who used xenophobia in their own campaign to get Britain out of the Union. I think that, again, what Donald Trump has done is appeal to those who have been hurt. And again, I said, the dislocation from 2008 is just starting to be eradicated. For the first time, wages have gone up in the United States, 5.6% income growth for the first time since the Great Recession. For the first time since the Great Recession, 3.2 million people have moved above the poverty line. Those are data that came out actually this morning, published in the New York Times. So nationalism is a dangerous thing. Again, I would just like to go back. I would not be surprised
And I think you will find, in fact, President Poroshenko said it yesterday on CNN, that all of the Euroskeptic movements have probably received funding directly from Russia. In whose interest is it to have Europe come apart? It's in Russia's interest to have Europe come apart.
Okay, Reno, back to the floor. Yes, our singer for the evening.
Hi, Nina Yankovic. So I want to talk a little bit more about immigration. And I was in Greece in April and met with Syrian refugees, little Syrian children who don't look very different than anybody in this room who have been displaced. And as the daughter of a refugee of World War II, I'm wondering how both of you answer to the fact that the United States has a moral imperative as a nation of immigrants to help these people out. What would your candidates do to assuage the greatest refugee crisis that we have since World War II? Thank you.
Who wants to go first?
Nina, thank you for your question, and it's a very important question. We recently had the, what I would think is a ridiculous tweet by Donald Trump's son, comparing Syrian refugees to poison Skittles. I mean, this is a terrible analogy. But those of you who do have a memory going back to World War II will remember Julius Streicher. Julius Streicher's magazine was the mouthpiece of the Nazi Party. And in that magazine, they had a folktale for children called The Toadstool. And in The Toadstool, parents taught their children that just one Jew is not only can ruin your family and ruin your neighborhood, but it'll ruin your town and your country. And that's the same analogy that Mr. Trump was making with the Skittles. What I got to get this in, Brian. What we have seen in this election is a debasing of our public dialogue. America needs to stand for what is right, what is just, what is good. That is what America really is. That's what our more perfect union is. Syrian refugees are people. They are not pieces of candy. They are not poison. They are not terrorists. The chances of finding a terrorist in Syrian refugees is something like 1 in 3.5 billion. And I think we've done a pretty good job of making sure we don't bring terrorists into the United States. We need to reestablish the United States as that beacon on the hill. We are the country that everybody looks to. And I know, going back to this discussion about Ukraine and Russia and so on, listen, guys, this is a binary choice. You got one guy who thinks Vladimir Putin, Kim Jong-un, and David Duke are great people, and you got another one who has some experience as Secretary of State, a senator for two terms, was in the White House. I think you better make your choices pretty carefully.
Jonathan.
Okay, so the refugee crisis, one of the significant reasons it exists is because of the meddlesome political establishment in Washington, D.C., because they're stoking these terrible conflicts around the world. That's one of the primary reasons why there are all those desperate people. Okay, so what works best, what is proven to work best, is to send them money so that they can be resettled in a country which is acclimated to their culture. That's what I would suggest doing about it.
Okay.
Oh, and let me respond real quick to a couple comments by Reyna. So if you look at any of those statements that Donald Trump made about Kim Jong-un or Putin, if you look at them in context, they're almost always bracketed by some type of criticism where they make a whole lot more sense. He's not praising dictators. He's in the situation of Putin, he was talking about Putin's ability to control his country. So
okay. All right, let's. We got 20 minutes left, so order drinks. The show gets better the more you drink. So
I have one more question about immigration.
Go for it.
I think the Ukrainians will enjoy this one. Why? First part of the question is this: why don't Middle Eastern countries accept all these Middle Eastern Muslim refugees? Why is it only the United States has to take them and Western Europe? Second, Why doesn't America accept more white Ukrainians into the United States? Why is it so hard for Ukrainians to get visas to come to our country?
Okay, who wants that one?
I'll take your first part of your question. I think you're incorrect. I don't think that the United States is the only...
Okay,
excuse me.
Let him answer.
I think you're incorrect. I don't think the United States is the only country taking refugees in the world.
Western Europe and the U.S. That's it.
You said America, so...
No, I said both. Western Europe and the
U.S. Second, I think it is our obligation as a country to be able to assist refugees when we can. I think that your criticism of some of the more wealthy Middle Eastern countries is a valid one. I don't answer for them. I'm not working for those people. I can't say what is in the mind of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, but again, I wish that they would do more about that. And third, the question about Ukrainians immigrating to the United States. First of all, it is easier to get visas than it used to be, in case you're not aware of that. Second of all, in this particular election season, visa issuing has become a big issue because immigration's become a big issue.
Unless you're Muslim and they just come
on. No, that's not true. You're simply wrong about that. I mean, that's not true. Muslims don't simply just come. And you know what? I really don't need a religious test on who comes to the United States. I don't care what religion they are. If they can come to the United States and help build the country. Listen, I'm Italian American. There were no laws about immigration until Italians came to the United States. That's when they created this Origins Act in 1923. It was aimed at Italian Americans. It was aimed at my people. So don't tell me about immigration. I know all about it.
Okay, Jonathan.
So the United States right now has a quantity. They have a quota system for immigration when what would make much more sense is to have a merit system of immigration where we would look at different factors like, do they speak English fluently? Do they have a certain level of education? Are they coming with children? Are they a single male? And that's badly what we need. If we were to adopt a meritocratic system of selecting immigrants, a lot of Americans would be a whole lot more happier with the immigrants that we were having, and this discussion would not be as emotionally compelling as it's been for the past year.
Okay, wait a second. Ukrainians in the crowd, raise your hand. Do you care who becomes president of the United States? And okay, and why? And what are you most concerned about in terms of U.S. foreign policy towards Ukraine? Anybody? All right, wait. Why don't you, nobody wants to ask, so we'll go to the Austrian.
Sorry, Ukraine was one country 100 years ago, so I take it.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm very happy about it. Question is, in 2 years there will be the NATO summit again. Now we just had the NATO summit in Warsaw. The question is, in 2 years there will be again a NATO summit. Ukraine's application will be on the table. What will you do as President Clinton or President, I don't hope, Trump, but what will you actually do in order to support NATO application, NATO membership of Ukraine?
Who wants it? NATO membership for Ukraine. Will the U.S. support that?
Under Trump, I'm really not sure.
I'll say this. Under Trump, there may not be any NATO to join. So I think the whole question about our transatlantic defense alliances really are very important in this election, because Donald Trump has said that NATO commitments may be dependent on who pays their bill, because he's a businessman after all. So this is a transactional agreement. It's not an international policy. And it was interesting. I listened to the interview on Hromadsky TV that you had with one of Trump's main guys here, Newt Gingrich, who said that NATO membership for the Baltic countries was an emotional decision and probably should have been thought out more carefully to begin with. I think Ukraine's membership in NATO, again, it will be a process. But again, will there be a NATO is the big question in this election.
Sir, identify yourself.
My name is Christopher. I am from Texas, born and raised. My question is directed at Jonathan. We've talked a lot about foreign policy right now. I'd like to get back to domestic policy. To put it very politely, Donald Trump and his supporters have a tenuous relationship with the Black Lives Matter movement. What do you think is the cause of this issue between the two parties, and what do you think Donald Trump could or should do about the growing growing unrest within the Black community in the United States?
Thanks for the easy question. Okay, so I watch a whole lot more YouTube videos than I probably should, and when I watch YouTube videos, I've seen surprisingly few conflicts between Black Lives Matter activists and between Trump supporters. I mean, you look at, like, there was the RNC, and there was some different commentators out there that were saying that the RNC is going to be just assaulted by political instability because of a disconnect between Black Lives Matter and the Republicans, and there was about 150 protesters total at the RNC, and so I'm not seeing that there's a huge amount of conflict between those. What I would mention, the important thing is that we make our economy very strong, and that as our economy gets strong, we're going to see a lot of those people that's going to help all of what's the problematic stuff that's going on with Black Lives Matter. Because if you have a job to go to the next morning, you're not going to be getting into trouble that's going to be sparking these incidents.
Reno,
again, a lot here. Why is there a Black Lives Matter movement? Is because a lot of people who are doing things like you're just discussing, Jonathan, just going to a job, get stopped in a routine car stop, and the next thing they're shot. That's why there's a Black Lives Matter movement to begin with, because we have a disproportionate number of African Americans and minorities killed in police shootings. Now look, I'm a big police guy. I support the American police. I was a high school principal, as Jonathan mentions. We had a very close relationship with our police department. Our police department doesn't do those kinds of things. They're very well trained. But the Washington Post had a study published a few weeks ago. As of right now, there have been over 700 fatal police shootings in the United States this year. Of that number, over half are either African American or minorities. There is a problem. And the problem's got to be addressed. The solution to the problem is not to blame other people, to blame the other. The people who should be most concerned about violence in police stops ought to be the police. They should be the most concerned about it.
Okay, I want to ask a question. We're coming to the closing, the gripping conclusion, the closing argument or arguments here. So, but Reno, my bias is clear. I'm for Hillary Clinton, but don't you have to give Donald Trump credit for many things, including exposing the corruption in the American political system, how it's inundated with dollars? And we talked about it becoming an oligarchy 4 years ago. And he also destroyed the Bush dynasty, which I think you probably welcome. If he's so bad, why is he so popular? He's tapping into the anger and resentment that many Americans feel towards the elites that are represented by Hillary Clinton.
Well, I'm not going to give Donald Trump credit for any of that. At this point in time, I think Donald Trump is making the Bushes look good in a comparative manner of speaking. Why we have so much money in politics today is because of Citizens United. Citizens United says that corporations are people. Well, I'll believe corporations are people when that gentleman's state, Texas, executes one. Citizens United is causing everyone to have to raise much more money. The only way we're going to get it out is to bring back campaign finance reform and bring this back into some order. Again, Donald Trump is tapping into dissatisfaction, but by tapping into dissatisfaction, what he ought to be doing is encouraging people to work together. And he ought to be encouraging people to get along together. He ought to be encouraging people to stand together, not dividing, not pulling people apart based on ethnicity, sex, religion. All of this is completely negative.
Okay, Jonathan, I have a question for you. What is so bad about Hillary Clinton? She is like, she is one of the smartest women in the world. She's clearly perhaps the most qualified person ever to run for president. She's been first lady. She's been U.S. Senator from New York. She's been Secretary of State. And on a moral scale, she stayed with her husband, unlike your candidate. What is wrong with Hillary Clinton?
So, as I said in my opening statement, the primary thing that really disgusts me and a lot of other people is that Washington establishment, which is in the war business. And that just, that I think that's a really gross thing. And she has been in there in the very core as a very important player in the government throughout all of these, throughout these things that we did in other countries where we screwed up these other countries royally, and where they're now, people are arriving in Greece because they're countries have just been turned into hell holes. And she has been at the very core of the government as all of that has happened. The other thing that I think is that speaks really clearly, because it's really recent and we know almost all the details, we can't make up crazy conspiracy theories about it, is the email scandal. That email scandal is just such a clear case of incompetence. Whenever I hear interviews with people that are elite lawyers or people that are IT specialists, security specialists that really know what they're talking about, they say there's no way that could have been a mistake. They say that is a sign of the real corruption and of the criminality of her and of what she's done in the government for a long time. So that would be my primary moral argument against her.
Okay. Unless we have a burning question from the floor, somebody who hasn't asked a question, you have not asked a question yet, in the front.
Thank you. My name is Chris from Kansas, and I guess my question is really relevant towards you, Jonathan, and your support for Trump being against the war. Currently, we have about 5,000 troops in Iraq, up to that number, and about the next president will have 10,000 troops in Afghanistan, and I think 300 troops in Syria. How will, I guess, either of the candidates, in your view, help in the bring these conflicts to an end and get our soldiers home? Thank you.
Jonathan.
I think Trump has suggested that we stop messing with these countries. I think we're going to see a whole lot less of our troops in those countries underneath of President Trump.
Reno, quickly.
Is that, Jonathan, because of the secret plan to get rid of ISIS? I mean, you can't say on one hand, I'm going to take care of this, I'm going to take care of that, we're going to have a beautiful solution to this war, we're going to crush ISIS, we're going to crush them tomorrow, and not explain how you're going to do any of that. The gentleman's point is very correct. And we also have troops here in Ukraine now, and everybody, I think, knows that, and probably will continue to have them.
Okay.
The fact of the matter is that these conflicts have been going on a long time. I think we've made a lot of progress in the fight against ISIS. It's an asymmetrical warfare. I think that I have no idea what a President Trump would do about any of these things. I can't imagine because, again, if you look on his website, there's no information about any of this, except that it's going to be beautiful, big and beautiful. Okay. But I don't know what it is.
We're in the closing argument phase. This is the final countdown. As moderator, I'm going to take my last, because there wasn't much discussion about Ukraine. As an American who's made Ukraine his home for many years, I'm very concerned. And what I want from the next president is strong support for Ukraine, financial, visa-free travel, defensive weapons, pushing Western allies to take a harder stance against Russia, which I believe under Vladimir Putin is one of the great threats of the world. So I want an America that is bipartisan, Republicans, Democrats, all parties in strong support of Ukraine. Now with that, and that's going to weigh very heavily on votes, and there's how many of us, how many millions of Americans live abroad?
That's a good question. It's been estimated that there's 8 million, some people say 6.5. We do know that in 2012, only 4% of that number of people cast ballots from abroad. Only 4%. So
wait,
even if it's...
Cast your ballot.
I'll get to that.
So
I'll get
vote
to that.
From abroad.
We have votefromabroad.org. It's a nonpartisan tool. Anybody can request their ballot from votefromabroad.org. One of the reasons, and you're taking my closing statement, but I might as well throw it in. One of the reasons why we had this debate tonight was to make sure all Americans know and understand how important it is to request your ballot now. And by now, I mean this week. Because if you don't request it now, it's going to take 2 weeks for that request to be processed in the states, and another 2 weeks for that ballot to get back here. So when you go home tonight, you need to go to votefromabroad.org if you have not requested your ballot and request it. If your friends have not requested their ballot, they need to go to votefromabroad.org and request their ballot. And the last thing I need you to do is I need you to call your friends back home and remind them to vote. They don't have to go to votefromabroad.org, but they need to vote anyway.
Okay. Thank you. And now... vote, whoever you're going to vote for, just vote. Jonathan, 3 minutes to sum it all up.
Okay, so governments never get smaller. Governments are these blood-sucking vampires that consume the freedom of the people that live within their borders. And in the United States, we have this constitution, we have some traditions, we have some things that were written down a long time ago to try to structurally create a state that will not strangle the liberties of the people that live in it. And there we have we have our government on a very scary course of constricting our liberties and not giving the people the freedom that they need. I'll paraphrase Thomas Jefferson. He said that liberty requires a new generation, a new revolution every generation. And we live in this era where we're lucky that revolutions do not have to occur with swords and bombs and guns. Revolutions can occur with words and arguments and philosophy, and our government is just growing too large and too powerful. Real good example, there's a plant, a very benign plant from Southeast Asia called kratom, that kind of works like medical marijuana. It has a lot of the same medicinal benefits. And a month ago, the DEA announced that it's going to ban this completely benign plant, and it really does help a lot of people. A lot of veterans of the military use it to maintain. It's very, very useful. Yet,
and this is Jonathan's business, right? We're now promoting. All right, wrap it up. You got exactly 30 seconds.
So Trump is our last chance to vote for a person that is going to disrupt the establishment, that is going to constrict our liberties and continue this insane perpetual war upon the rest of the world.
Okay, thank you, Jonathan. Reno Domenico, last word.
Again, I'd like to thank all of you for coming out this evening. You made this a great event. It seems like it was just a couple of minutes. I hope it wasn't boring for you, because it certainly wasn't boring for me. Maybe we'll go on for a couple more hours in a green room or something, Jonathan. I want to thank Jonathan for coming. It was a tough spot to be in, and I give him credit for standing up here and making his case. And again, I'd like to thank the Kyiv Post and Hromadske TV and the Golden Gate for their hospitality this evening. I want to tell you a reason why I really wanted to be a delegate to the Democratic Convention in Philly. I was a high school principal, and before that I was a teacher of history and social science. And I never forget, I was teaching American Revolution, and we were having a lesson on the presidency, and one of the girls in my class, and this was quite a while ago, she raised her hand and she said, "Mr. Domenico, I'm looking at this list here of presidents. They're all men." I said, "Yeah, they are." I said, "But it won't stay that way forever." And this is, I was so proud to have the opportunity to be a delegate, to actually vote, to make Hillary Clinton not only the best candidate for president of the United States, but the first woman candidate of any major political party in the history of the United States. I think this election is going to come down to who has the best vision for the future. The gentleman asked a great question about what are the policies, and we probably didn't talk enough about them tonight. But go to Hillary's website. She does have her issues spelled out clearly. They are there. She has substance. She knows what she's doing. This won't be a shot in the dark. Jonathan, I agree with you on the idea that every society needs a revolution. And don't forget, Jefferson was a Democrat. And what we don't need is a fascist revolution. We don't need a nationalist revolution. What we need is a step into the future. And that's what this election's about. Hillary Clinton is the one to lead us. We need stable, rational, sane leadership that addresses the serious questions in our country, that does not divide us, that pulls us together, that doesn't discuss xenophobia, misogyny, racism, bigotry, that makes America seek to be that more perfect union. We've had a great 8 years under Barack Obama. He's been a beautiful president with a beautiful family, and we really don't need to follow that up with something negative. So I urge everybody to vote for Hillary. And again, please, Americans, votefromabroad.org. You have to get your ballot now. If you don't get your ballot now, it's too late. Votefromabroad.org. Every American, even Trump voters, can do that.
Okay. Everybody, that's our show for the evening. If you really can't get enough of politics, tune in at 4 a.m. Kyiv time, where you'll hear Hillary and Donald go after it. But can we applaud one more time this great set of panelists? We hope you enjoyed the show. And Nina, do you have another song in you tonight?
I don't, but me and Nolan might go do an open mic on Thursday. So watch our Twitter.
Okay, great voice. Thank you all for coming. Good night.
Sure.